on one of the biggest discoveries, as Lyndon LaRouche had mentioned it this morning in his speech, that is how, through the work of Haydn, and when Mozart listened to it and had worked through Johann Sebastian Bach's works, a new concept, Motivführung, was introduced in the composition, up until, which is a leading concept up until today. But it is a big rediscovery. And we will, because it will give a sense of coherence which so far only very few people actually have understood and know about. Now, this work, which will be presented tonight, is an outgrowth of many years of work, and an earlier result of this, and this was done during the time Lyndon LaRouche was incarcerated, was the manual on the rudiments of tuning and registration, which I think by now most of you have read. If not so, feel encouraged afterwards to buy it and to study it at home. With the title, Book One, Introduction and Human Singing Voice, and it was published in 92, and under the direction of Lynn, people like John, René Sigerson, Cassie, and other people were working on it to put it together. By the way, only very recently, even in German music, famous music papers, monthly, got a very good review. Swiss papers reviewed it, even if it's not yet published in German, but we are on the way to do so. Now, before I go on, I would like to give a special greeting to our guest, Sylvia Olden Lee. You heard yesterday. I think all of you heard her yesterday playing in this beautiful concert. And I would like to ask her actually to say to us a couple of words, if she is willing, to come forward to the microphone. She herself is coming on a very musical family. Her father was a member of the Fisk Quartet together with Roland Hayes. Her mother was pianist and singer. And as she told me earlier, she had 7 years you were in Munich. Therefore, I would like to say herzlich willkommen.
Herzlichen Dank. You lovely, beleaguered people, as unaccustomed as I am to any kind of speaking, I ramble on, but to do it in a formal way, it's going to be a bust. But I was applauded so much for what I did yesterday, and I just want you to really think about it. I would be no good were it not for the fact that I am accompanying soloists who, whether their accompaniment was good or not, you're not paying attention to it. You are listening to the message that does come from the singers, such as we had Bob McFerrin. He's incomparable, and also he's a Fiskite. Mr. Roland Hayes, whom I got to know almost from birth, and had a meeting with him about 5 or 6 months before his death, did some work with him. He told me exactly how to do Angel Mole songs. And he and Daddy stood as tenors, elbow to elbow, for 5 long years at Fisk University as half of the Fisk Quartet. And his daughter is here, and I guess you've learned that already. But Africa is here, and she got to get up so that everybody will know of her. And the father is just not describable. We won't take up the whole evening talking about him, but I could, because he was the soul of dignity and ethics and truth and reality, no nonsense, and was a dignified prince all the time. And he, who reached the heights way back in the 20s and 30s of the Carnegie Hall and higher level, and went abroad and was decorated by so many of the crowned heads, he sang with a dedication and a special message from different languages, at least five. And you never got the idea that, well, he has nice pronunciation. No, he had a message with everything he sang. So he did Bach and Schütz and Debussy and the French, Italian, and German, for which he really deserved every bit of the credit that he got. Then, most of the time, I don't know about all the time, but he certainly did include his songs and did them with dignity. There was nothing patronizing about it, and I have now risen higher, and it's so nice to remember my people's songs. None of that. It was another message, and he said for all of us to recognize, along with the classics, to never forget that the songs of people were real, and to do them no matter whether dialect, and you know that all Negro spirituals are not in dialect. There's some that are very, very straightforward. But to sing them with dignity and without making a travesty of them, to think deep and to do the very best you could. Now, I am speaking from a Fisk family to which I never belonged, because I am the granddaughter of a slave, and I found one of my cousins lately. My grandfather lived long enough for me to get to know him, so you know that makes me absolutely Jurassic or something. But I got to know my grandfather, who was born this slave and who came at the end of the war to Nashville, from Kentucky, the Kentucky plantation, Oldham. But he decided he didn't want to keep that dumb spelling, he said. He would call it Olden. So he came up to Fisk and met my grandmother, who was fortunate because her father was the founder of the Baptist Church still standing, 1853. She was the daughter of the minister. She was a Jubilee singer, one of the first. She did not go abroad and get her portrait painted by Victoria's portraitist because her father drew the line. No daughter of mine is traipsing all over foreign countries. So she couldn't go, but she was a Jubilee singer. She married this George Olden, and then they had my father, who was a theologue. He was studying for the ministry, but he belonged to this quartet, the Fisk Quartet people. Roland Hayes was the only one who was a music major. The rest of them, Dr. Wesley of the Wilberforce, president of Wilberforce, was a classics major, and Len Foster was a sociologist. And they had, even though they had their pursuits, if you were a Fisk quartet person, you couldn't just get up and throw a few spirituals around, because it was quite easy for them to sing. They're close to the atmosphere all around. Fisk is built on the spirit of the spiritual. They had jobs every other Saturday to get up early and go horse and buggy into the wilds, which that's true, of Tennessee, bringing back new spirituals. But every one of those members of the quartet had also to study lieder, chanson, canzone. They had to study voice technique. They had to know piano, and they had to read. So they had to add to what they had as a curriculum and get up and perform classics. my father and Dr. Wesley at many an NAACP meeting in the teens and 20s. When they needed a musical interlude, Daddy and Charlie got up and did the duet from the Forza del Destino. And Dr. Wesley would sing very capably the Evening Star from Tannhäuser. So my first accompaniment, I started very early, and by the time I was 8, Daddy was doing a little of his leftover classics. I remember my first accompanying was to accompany him in Du Bist Die Ruhe of Schubert. And then when I got ambitious, he said, do Hark, Hark, the Lark. So I worked very hard at that. I was 8 years old, and I worked. It was in the key of C, and all I had to do was really put some time to it. I remember it very well. Later in all these long years, we journeyed, my family, my husband and 2 children, we went to München, to Munich, for only 1 year, but it ended up, it was 7. And while we were there, we gave programs because Bonn had asked our consulate if we knew of anybody who could do a whole program of spirituals. And I asked every Negro colored African American who was there if he would consent to do it. They had a tour ready, and nobody wanted to do this. So I thought of going to the head of USIA and saying, you know, you folks, he was white, you think anything that isn't spirituals is jazz or something, but we have a full ledger of offerings creatively for vocal singing. Why don't you let me get an anthological, starting with the African chant unaccompanied and coming with the earliest spiritual, 1619, 1630, and bring it on around to the work songs, play songs, the street cries, which you know are so wonderful, and then to Creole songs, and then our art songs. It has been found lately there are more than 1,000 composers, black composers of serious music. I would never have thought that. I thought the most would be 150 or 200. But Dr. DeLarima has made that discovery. So we would do, soon as we would get this program together and go, they would always ask us, or quite frequently say before we went out, could you possibly come back next week too, because we've turned away a whole auditorium of spirituals. There also were published over a dozen editions of Negro spirituals published in Germany with the German translation. And they would have us to come and sing the original and then to teach them how to do the spiritual in their language. And after we had gotten through with, there is a balm in Gilead, I'm sure that a lot of you know that, one of the folks walked up and said, you know, this sounds so, it has no African sound to me. It seems quite like Schubert. And so I said, well, that would naturally happen if the masters loved music and had to have it. They had live music only. And they would find the most talented of the slaves and train them as well as they could and have them to entertain so that they would go around and hear other music, and they'd hear the classics. And that's why we're coming closer together. Many a spiritual has an 18th, 19th century patina that goes through it. There are a lot of them that are still tribal, and I have a list of about 300. And they're different kinds, some of them quite martial, and you can hear the tom-toms in it. And others are very, very tuneful and sound about like Danny Boy. And it only shows that we are closer and closer if we all will work very, very diligently. I know from the fact that you're here, your presence attests to the fact that you believe in justice and one world. I hope you keep persevering and going into the far corners of this globe, selling it to other people, because we are one family. We all belong to one God, no matter what you call him. And as such, we should keep in touch with each other through classics and folk music.
Now, on the theme of Motivführung, part of the documented material which John will use to explain the actual discovery, what we call the Mozart Revolution, is material which we featured in a film coming from a presentation which Professor Brainin agreed to do a year ago, actually, on the date in February last year near a town in Trier. And at the time, it just was possible that he could stay there for a day and was working with the young quartet in Germany, the Henschel Quartet, and had said, fine, why don't I use now the good young people there and I show how actually Haydn, how actually the revolution, how the Motive, the Motivführung was developed. Now, it is so, and I therefore have a great pleasure that Norbert Brainin is among us and will listen to this now, and I would like to give a special welcome to Norbert Brainin. You know, to comment, I think he's definitely, you know, we would like to have him here then. Now, I don't hope to violate some privacy, but I hope you forgive me if I mention one little exchange you had with Lynn at a time when there was discussion on the Mozart, Haydn, back and forth, thinking, you know, how it works. And then at some point, you mentioned in the discussion, well, actually, if I think about it, there might be only two people who really understand what Motivführung is all about, like at the time with Haydn and Mozart. It's you, Lynn, and Norbert. So I think from this, we definitely will learn. And I would invite now John to speak on the Haydn and Mozart creative discovery of classical polyphony.
Thank you, Anno. I have to admit that I had absolutely no idea that Norbert would be in the room when I was preparing this presentation. So definitely, if you have anything to add or subtract. Okay. So this evening, and I know it's late, but I don't think you'll go to sleep in this presentation. There's too much going to be going on up here. I hope to further infect you with the germ of an idea about one of the most profound and exciting discoveries of the last 500 years. This discovery was made in the field of classical beauty by two creative musical scientists, Joseph Haydn and Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart, over the course of approximately four short years, 1781 to 85, give or take a couple of years. Although they also owe a considerable debt to Johann Sebastian Bach's preparatory work, which was done up through Bach's own death in 1750. Haydn and Mozart's discovery quickly unleashed an explosion in musical creativity, reaching a high point, as Lynn mentioned earlier on, in the later works of Ludwig van Beethoven in the second decade of the 19th century, but continuing to reverberate throughout the century in the works of such people as Franz Schubert, Robert Schumann, Johannes Brahms, and Antonin Dvorak, and beyond, as we see in the spirituals. A little over a year ago, I and two associates were delegated to visit Mr. LaRouche in prison to interview him on the matter of this musical revolution. Although there's no doubt that over the past century and more, many musicians and others have been deeply affected by Haydn's and Mozart's discovery, whether they knew it or not, it is in fact the case that were it not for the efforts of Lyndon LaRouche to make this revolution intelligible, we as a civilization would likely have lost any clear sense of this discovery's importance and how it can be applied today and in the future. During the course of our discussion tonight, during our visit, LaRouche emphasized that, he said, the difference between natural beauty, that is, the harmonic orderings found in the created physical universe, and creative beauty, is purpose. It's the articulation of purpose. Creative beauty, he added, is a goad to purpose, where the purpose rises above the simple idea of fixed morality. That is, morality simply defined as rules, as doing one's duty. Lynn emphasized that the only way that people are going to discover art again and science is by that purpose. The Haydn-Mozart discovery of Motivführung, the generative principle for ordering thematic material, is one of the landmark examples of moral purpose generated through art. For this discovery gave to classical composition, for the first time, a power of coherence, of intelligible progression of ideas, which had never existed before. In a more recent discussion with Lynn, he returned to the same theme in a discussion of around our preparations to release volume 2 of a manual on the rudiments of tuning and registration for teachers and political leaders. LaRouche emphasized that music is in fact a perfect medium for examining the principle of scientific discovery, which has permitted mankind to develop over the course of history. You'll see later on this evening how perfect a medium music is for mastering the method of scientific discovery. And returning to our moral purpose, our desire to save and develop mankind without this language, without this tool, without a new musical revolution today and tomorrow and the next day, we'll never be able to win the political battle to save civilization. Now, what's the nature of this Haydn-Mozart revolution? How can each of us here learn to identify and then to study, and quite possibly perform, those works in which the newly discovered principles are present? How can we determine when the principle is not present? The approach I'm going to take tonight to answer this will be to have you hear the principle in action in two works where it's very hard to miss. First, a string quartet written by Haydn in 1781, which is called his Opus 33. Opus simply means work. So it's Opus 33, number 3 in C major, also known as the Bird Quartet, for a reason which will be quite evident. And second, another string quartet composed 4 years later by Mozart. His Kerschel 464. Kerschel was the cataloger of Mozart's work. So all of his works bear the Kerschel or K number. 464, which shows you how many works he wrote, at least. Many more than that in his short life. In A major. And this is one of the six quartets with which Mozart dedicated to his elder friend, Haydn. We'll hear them with the aid of sections of this of the videotape, the film, which Anno has just mentioned. I just might mention that you should be aware that Dr. Brainin and Mr. LaRouche have been engaged in this dialogue for many years now. First, what I'm going to do, before I do that, I want to add something. Although you're going to be hearing tonight a lot of string music, that is music which does not have human singers, it has human players of instruments, you should always keep in mind that a musical instrument is a means of extending something, extending the beautiful singing of the bel canto human voice. There's no such thing as purely instrumental music as opposed to vocal music. Any instrumentalist who doesn't sing on his instrument just as beautifully as Robert McFerrin did last night should think again before he gets up and does something in front of other people. I'm going to play these, but we're going to hear the string music, but this happens to be very beautiful singing music, so I think you'll hear that right away. So I'm going to be playing some excerpts from these two string quartets, which is going to be, you're going to see a video film on that screen. And then as we go on that screen, you're going to see the musical score swing by you, right? For the benefit of those who can follow it. Now don't worry if you can't follow it. Later on, we'll be coming back to various of these sections a number of times, and we can point things out. So first, I would like you to hear the first movement of Haydn's Opus 33, number 3. We will be hearing an excerpt of that, not the whole thing. Thank you. And now, in rapid succession, we're going to hear vignettes from each of the four movements of Mozart's Kürschel number 464. Already, listen hard and you will hear both see if you can hear the similarities and the differences even before we say anything more about them. Okay, we'll start, it'll be four movements. We'll start with the first movement. Now we're going to do the second movement. It's a minuet, dance movement. Now the third movement, which is a slower movement, andante, which means walking. Thank you. And now the last movement. Allegro. Happy. What you just heard were beautiful examples of the principle of Motivführung. Motivführung comes from, the word comes from the two German words, Motiv, which means theme or motivation, and Führung, which is related to the verb to lead. This is the principle of least action in the domain of polyphonic composition. That is, just as Leibniz, Huygens, the Bernoullis discovered and investigated least action nature of cycloidal action, thereby launching a revolution in technology, so Haydn and Mozart discovered how what we might call motivic action or motivic change, how that could lead to creating works with a maximum unity of the whole, while at the same time preserving the maximum individuality of the multiple individual voices within the work. Now, such a principle is implicit even in the individual well-trained bel canto singing voice and in the singing of great poetry. As the Schiller Institute has documented in volume one of the music manual, the human singing voice already has a God-given geometry and internal organization such that each of the six basic species of singing voice are divided into well-defined registers. Here you see a chart of the six species, soprano, alto, contralto, tenor, baritone, bass, and where their registers divide. And this allows, as the music manual documents in great detail, how any individual voice can also sing in multiple voices simply by shifting register, if the register is properly understood and properly executed by the performing artist. Now, these registers, in turn, are also implicit in, as Jonathan went through earlier on today, in the harmonic organization of the non-human physical domain, as Kepler demonstrated by proving that the relative locations of the planets in our solar system are not arbitrary, but rather are a quantum field of least action pathways. Now, the history of musical composition. And here I'm only talking about composition as a means of seeking truth and beauty, and not mere entertainment or titillation of the senses, is the history of the quest for doing two apparently paradoxical things. First, enhancing this least action nature of the individual singing voice, the individual, and B, Second, a method by which many voices or species of voices singing simultaneously or in alternation or both can work in concert to create a beautiful consonant whole, while at the same time preserving the essential individuality of each individual voice. You simply can't have, that is, if you simply have the entire chorus doing the same thing, precisely, identically, the same kind of thing that each individual voice does, if it's operating on that same level, then you will not be able to get any achieve any distinction, a fundamental distinction between the ensemble as a whole, the chorus or the string quartet or the ensemble as a whole, and the individual voice. You need something special done in order to create that special personality for the entire ensemble. Now, the development of musical instruments and the classical symphony orchestra played a crucial role in discovering how to solve this problem, this seeming paradox. The musical instruments, far from replacing the human voice, when properly played, serve as a means to extend the range and flexibility of the human voices, while still preserving the human voice's own quantum field registral properties. The development of the violin family in Italy by circles around Leonardo da Vinci was a crucial advance. Centuries after circles around Leonardo developed these instruments by modeling them on the principles, same principle by which the cavities of the human head focus the singing voice, something quite wonderful happened with the violins. And by the violins, I'm talking about the violin, the viola, the cello, and the contrabass to a lesser degree. Excuse me. I thought that was Norbert over there interrupting me. But getting back to the stringed instruments, the violins, composers discovered that these instruments had a potential which the original inventors of the violin didn't even foresee, namely their ability to imitate more than one singing voice species. This is effected through changing the point at which the voice moves from one register to the next by changing the relative position of when you change from one string to the next. The stringed instruments were therefore quite different than the woodwind and the brass instruments, whose registers remain more or less fixed. For example, the violin, which is a soprano instrument, can imitate the registration of the bass voice, while the cello, which is a tenor or respectively a bass instrument, can function as a soprano. Now, especially the decades leading up to this 1781-85 Motivführung revolution were marked by numerous attempts to discover the right medium, exactly the right medium, the right combination of instrumental or singing voices for achieving the necessary breakthrough. In the vocal domain, you're probably familiar with the oratorio form used by Frederick Handel and Johann Sebastian Bach, which contain alternating sequences of full choruses and solo or duet pieces. Up through Mozart's time, most operas more or less also follow this oratorio format, so-called opera seria. In the instrumental domain, J.S. Bach used the concerto grosso, or large concerto form, in which each instrument played a solo and then became resubmerged into the total ensemble, or the accompaniment. While Bach's son, Carl Philipp Emanuel, worked on the Sinfonia Concertante, which focused on only a limited group of solo instruments. At the same time, in Italy, Luigi Boccherini was extending the use of the cello beyond the function of a kind of pedestal, a kind of bass fundament pedestal on which the other voices danced, towards that of a true singing voice, but which has the same responsibilities of the other higher voices, except also has special responsibilities as well. Now, all of these subsidiary inventions came to fruition in Haydn's invention of the string quartet, two violins, viola, and cello, as the ideal medium for his and Mozart's revolution. And out of this, these four instruments were forged as the central voice of the full classical symphony orchestra. It wasn't arbitrary that we have our classical symphony orchestra today. It's the result of a revolution. It's not something to be sniffed at as something that just sort of happened that way. It was lawful that it happened that way. Finally, with the string quartet, they had found a way to give the ensemble its own big voice, a voice totally distinct, distinguishable, and yet totally coherent with each individual voice. This was the birth of what you can call true polyphony, as opposed to merely polyphonic counterpoint, multi-voiced counterpoint. It's the exemplification of the solution to Plato's paradox in the Parmenides of the one and the many. The perfection of this medium went hand in hand with the perfection of Motivführung itself. Now, let me describe the general procedure. So it doesn't, yes, it's a profound point, but there are ways that you can grasp how to do this rather easily. Take a very small little bit of musical material, say a single interval, like do, so, or so, do, or something like that. Right? Or a succession of two intervals. No, 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 no. Right? Da, dum, one interval. Da, dum, two intervals. Notice I'm singing intervals and not notes. That is, when you hear that, you're hearing two intervals, not four notes. You're hearing the intervals, not the notes. Or you can take a simple little ornament, da-da-dum, something like that. And you can run it, so you take that and then you run it upwards, and you run it downwards. Right? Then, take the same material, put it into another voice, turn it upside down, perhaps slow it down, and then run both voices, the original one and the one you've changed, in counterpoint. Then, use the resulting idea as the basis of everything in the entire piece. So that's it. It's not that very complicated. It really isn't. Now, let me show you how it works by taking some examples from what you've just heard. A little later, you're going to hear Dr. Brainin, and he's going to, on the video, and he's going to be referencing some of the same things. So you get another chance, you get another shot. In the Opus 30, number 3, Haydn's opening motif in the first violin is the following, and I'd like the first audio there. That's it. Okay, now let's have the first one of those again. Okay. Maybe you can do some pointing here. Let's look at the first violin one part. First, you have just a single note, excuse me. And then, in the next measure, you have a grace note ornament coming from below. Da-da, da-da, like that. Right? Then you have, right after that, a more elaborate ornament going above and below. Da-da-da-da. And ending off with a larger, generally downward flourish. Right. At first glance, you might think that this flourish is just a regular simple arpeggio, right? Something like that, like a strummed chord on a guitar or something. But when you look more closely, you see that the same grace note ornament is actually built in there. Dum dum da da dum da 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 dum that da dum right there, those first two notes. Right da 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 dum. Right da 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 dum. So that's da-dum, 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 da-dum. It's the same thing. It's built right in. Absolutely. Absolutely. That's exactly what I was just about to point out. It's right here. No, he's right. He's absolutely right. Is that the cello, this is a simple arpeggio in the cello, but notice that it's going in contrary motion to the flourish, that it's going upwards, right, as the violin is going downwards. But notice that it is, in this case, a straight arpeggio. Dum, bum, 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 bum. Right? Straight arpeggio. But then here's an interesting trick. Now, after a couple of restatement of this, Haydn then works this grace note idea into the bass line itself. Now let me have the, on the overhead, measures 18 through 21, and then the next audio. Now here, look at the cello line. It's da 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 da. I'm singing it higher because I can't sing that low, right? Right. It's not da 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 da. It's da 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 da. And then next, right? Da 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 da. Right. Da da da. Right there. Da da. Right. So you have the same kind of grace note worked into the bass. Now also at the same thing, keep that up, notice that you have this stepwise rising figure in the violin. That is, it's dum. Point, please. Point to measure 19. Right. Da 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 da. Right, have that going up there. Right. That's a rising figure there. Right, which still incorporates, though, this grace note by interposing this chromatic C sharp. That is, it's not just, it's da 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 da, it's da 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 da. So it's still in there. Totally in there. Now, I point out this chromatic passage here just because when you hear the Mozart Quartet later on, you'll notice that one of the big differences, very noticeable difference between the Haydn's initial idea and Mozart's elaborated breakthrough is Mozart's intensive use of this kind of chromatic, you would call it, motion. It's half-step motion. In order to provide maximum freedom for the quartet's big voice. Dr. Brainin will also have something to say about this on the video. Now we've got this grace note idea, and we've got this closely related stepwise ascending stepwise idea. Okay, now let's consider the following. Now can I have on the overhead measures 28 to 31 and the next audio. Okay. Now the original grace note figure is in the second violin. Notice that. Where are we here? Right. No, it's upside down. Yeah. Right. Right. Notice the second. Point out the second violin line there, please. Yeah. Notice. Dun, 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 dun. Maybe, John, if you could run that back just to play that again so people could hear it. Hear it? Right, okay. Right, and then in the first violin, the top part, you hear a shortened version of the original downward flourish. Da-da-da-da-dum, da-da-da-da-dum, right, at the same time. And then, after that, a very special kind of inversion, right, of the same flourish, which you've, a couple of notes have been subtracted, you can see, in ascending motion. Da-da-dum, dum-ba-dum, 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 that kind of thing. Very interesting. Right. And meanwhile, you have the viola, which is playing a stepwise descending line. Right? Dum, 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 dum. Just like that. On the top viola there. Yeah. Right there. Yeah. Dum, dee, mm, mm. Right. Play it once more, just so that everybody can hear it again. John? A lot going on. Okay. So as I said before, all we're doing is we're going up, we're going down, changing voices, inverting. It's great fun. Now, once we've understood what Haydn's doing here, we can take a look at the following development section. Now, in German, development is called Durchführung. I prefer it to the English word development. Durchführung simply means carrying something through, working it through, working it out, right? As opposed to the idea that somehow that there's something different and you have an exposition and something totally different in the development. It's really not that way. You're taking something and you're working through the implications of it. And we can share Mozart's profound excitement in this next carry-through section. When Mozart probably heard this thing work for the first time. Let me play the key passage for you. This is measure 66. Yeah, you've got it. No, start, that's you, or, yeah, you're right. Yeah, the next audio. Suddenly, and it's hard to hear this out of context, but that's why we're going to go back and forth. But everything's pulled together here into a unity by the way that Haydn has altered the cello line. In effect, Haydn has gotten you to hear both the grace note motive and the rising falling idea as a single idea. And in keeping with this, Haydn has the other instrument's lines gently rising and falling against the cello's energetic figure. Notice I have this dum-ba-dum, bum-ba-dum, bum-ba-dum. Notice that the notes with the arrows there, if you just pick those out, that's a falling line. And could you run that one again? Listen for the cello line, the bottom line. Dum, dum, dum. That thing. It's totally rigorously developed, that bottom line there. There's nothing arbitrary about it. It wasn't just something that occurred to him. He worked it through in a very exciting way. Now, as LaRouche emphasized recently, if you want to identify one single place where you can put your finger on the Haydn breakthrough. It's right here. It's right there, what you just saw. You may have to do more work to appreciate it fully, but I will tell you, it's right there. Now, what I'd like you to do now is let's hear the full first movement in context. I think this is it. Oh, you know what I have to do? Wait. Hmm. Wait one sec. Why don't we not have the score so that you can actually just try to concentrate on it by listening? here's the development section. Now we're going to continue with Dr. Brainin pointing out some of the same things I've indicated already. I will provide you a running translation. These quartets represent a new method of composition. We call it Motivführung. Haydn didn't call it that. He said simply, I'm publishing six quartets of a totally new, distinct species. And he writes that before these, he hadn't written any quartets for years. The last time he wrote a quartet was about 10 years earlier.
Olden Quartet.
These were the Opus 20 quartets, the so-called Sun quartets. This is a completely new method. You can have imagine it somewhat like this. During a conversation or a discussion, let's say among four people, there's discussion about one topic. This method means that you stick to the topic, that you don't drift off into other directions, so to speak, that you stick with it. The entire piece is constructed out of these building blocks, which you hear in the very first measures. I'd also like to say that coming from Haydn, this has great importance. Haydn actually invented the string quartet as we know it. He invented the sonata form. The sonata form was originally a bi-thematic sonata form. That is, the first and second themes were different, often completely different. Haydn changed that. And in this way, he did everything in a more unified way. Did it completely in the unity. The fact is that from this point on, up to today, every composer has used this method. I don't know anyone who doesn't use it, regardless of the content. But exactly this technique is used. That's how important this achievement and this change is. And Mozart, of course, recognized this immediately. Now that I've told you all this, I'd like to demonstrate this, how such a thing works. Can we play from the beginning? Right from the beginning. And over here we're going to have the fit. You'll see the score of what we're doing. These are the motives out of which the piece is constructed. If we can continue. You can hear him singing. That's not difficult to hear where it came from. Can you point to that? I'm going to stop there just so you can actually see. Wait. Okay. Yeah, could you point to that there? No. The first violin part up, further up. Yeah, that. That's what he's pointing to there. Okay. I'll try to stop more. Okay, let's go on. So that's also quite obvious. I'd like, we're talking about here is measures 18 through 26, please. Right. Right. Da 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 da. Right. As we went through before. There. Notice that's like a kind of ornament, except it's coming from the top. Okay.
Sogar das kommt sogar. Manchmal werden solche Wendungen.
Sometimes such turns of phrase are slowed down or speeded up. Sometimes they're inverted.
Contrary motion. That is allowed.
That's permitted, shall we say, to do that such things. Okay. Okay, now we go to measure 27. That's all very easy to recognize. Right? That's the same thing that we went through before. It's very easy to recognize. And now comes the second theme, second formal theme. This is measure 41 to 59.
There's
a second theme there. But the building blocks come from the beginning. Almost exclusively from these same little grace notes. Sometimes with a third. Ta-da. Or sometimes a half step. Ta-da. Now comes the Durchführung. Development. This differs very little from the exposition. As I said before, the whole thing is called motivic Durchführung, motivic carry through. Which means that the carry through actually starts right at the beginning. In this way. Well, now let's play from the double bar. There's very little or nothing new here. Measure 60 to 76. Right. It's playing that motive in the cello that you. And then you can refer back to measure 28, which is the one where it comes from. measure 28.
Ja, das ist Teller, ich spiele mal Kontakt 28.
Right. Okay, now we're going back to the development from measure 66. Second theme, obviously. We're about measure 88 now. These are all things which we already had before, which are presented in a new way. That's the essence of this method. Now, I just want to interject here, one of the beautiful things about this Motivführung is the way that it fosters a dialogue amongst composers, such that you have a realm of discourse, scientific discourse, an interchange of ideas that you really never had before, such that you'll find Mozart constantly quoting motivic elements from J.S. Bach and from Haydn, and Beethoven quoting liberally from all of them. It has nothing to do with plagiarizing or anything, since the essence of Motivführung is, in any case, change, and it's in incorporating other minds into your own mind, as Lynn went through and indicated earlier on today. So in that spirit, and just for fun, I'd like you to hear how Beethoven quoted from this Haydn quartet. This is from I'll have you guess, but just the way he's quoting is he has repeated, think of this, you've got repeated notes at the beginning. Dum bum 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 bra. And then an ornament, repeated notes and an ornament. And now play the audio. Okay, as you can see, that's the for those of you who might not have been able to guess, that's the scherzo, or the joke movement from Beethoven's Eighth Symphony. Beethoven's also quoting himself here, since before that he composed a canon for four voices. Ta 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 ta, lieber, lieber Mälzel, which is dedicated to Mälzel, who was the inventor of the metronome. Now, listen to how Beethoven then modifies his own work in the next audio selection, later on in the same symphony. Speeds it up. Can it louder? Thank you. to return to the film, Dr. Brainin's going to now point out the leading features of the Motivführung in Mozart's A major quartet. This will be followed by a performance of just the first and the last movements of the quartet, rather than the whole thing, because I don't want to stretch your attention too late tonight. Okay.
Und ich wollte Ihnen auch...
Moment. Yes.
Jetzt zeigen, wie das...
Yes.
Und zwar, wir wählten uns heute sein Quartett.
Machine is not obeying me.
I just wanted to say a few things which need to be said. You see, when I started to play quartets, I had not the faintest idea about the Motivführung. Actually, I find a very good English the translation is motivic development. As you said, it's a development which starts right at the beginning of the piece, really. And it was only gradually that it dawned on me. And why did I come across it? Because it all happened in string quartets, which was my job at the time. And and you see, as I said, it came suddenly. It dawned on me that the importance of this, and in particular Mozart's response to Haydn's change. By the way, Haydn's change, it amounts to really, and this we didn't say this properly. It amounts to a change from a dual thematic sonata form to a mono thematic sonata form, really. This is what it means. Namely, the second subject, which is maybe there or may not be there, is made up entirely of elements of the first subject, or the beginning of the first motifs, you see. Now, I have seen references to this in books which I read, particularly a book by a man called Geiringer, a Viennese musicologist who spent a great part of his life in Santa Barbara, California, teaching. But it was, in fact, when I thought it, that this Motivführung was important, I tried to look for the thing. It was very difficult for me to find the place where he mentions it, which is an indication as to the fact that he didn't put any great importance on this at all. Also, I looked in vain for a mention of this in Alfred Einstein's book. I couldn't find it. And of course, Robbins Landon, this English Haydn and Mozart expert, he does mention it, but sort of en passant. And the idea is, of course, what I'm trying to say is, that nobody attached any great importance to this. And I did attach importance to it. I couldn't understand why these people who are such learned people have not cottoned on to the importance of this, which is really a watershed in the history of musical composition. And when I mentioned this to Lynn LaRouche, he understood immediately. In fact, he was the only person in the whole world who understood what I was talking about. Which reminded me of the time when Haydn wrote these quartets. There were six quartets, which are Opus 33, also called Russian quartets because they were dedicated to Tsar Alexander the First or the Third. I'm not quite sure. Don't let that bother you. It's not important. Now, when Haydn wrote this, yes, and Mozart immediately understood what this was all about. And this made him write six quartets, which he dedicated to Haydn, and called them the Haydn quartets. You see? Now, these two chaps, they were at this time also the only two people in the whole wide world who understood this great development and this in the history of music making and composition. And I think between Lynn and me, there is a parallel of this, of some sort.
Which is Haydn and which is Mozart? Okay, let's do some work on Mozart.
Okay. Und zwar aus zwei Dingen. Erstens einmal, weil die Motivführung sehr stark ist und auch die
I've chose this because the Motivführung is very strong here.
Einfluss von Johann Sebastian.
And also because the influence of Johann Sebastian Bach can be very clearly discerned.
I'd
like to hear this. Start at the beginning.
Zum Schluss haben wir vor Ihnen das ganze A-Dur Quartett.
At the end, we intend to play the full one. But right now,
I'd
just like to show some examples. These 16 measures contain all the material for the rest of the piece. It's very easy to recognize. But, wait, just put that up again, put the beginning up. All right. I just want to make sure it's in the very beginning. I just want to point out now, notice that it's related because you have two notes here instead of a lot of repeated notes, but then there's an ornament which goes below and above. Da 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 da, right? And then another da da da, so it's two ornaments like, right? And then dum bum bum dum, going upwards, and then, but look at the bass down there, right? Dum 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 dum, right? So notice that's going down, right? Okay? Okay, now let's proceed. They're going to proceed from measure 17. On, okay. Please pay attention here to the chromatic element, which is also there right at the beginning. See, that's exactly what I was saying. Da, 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 da. That's from the very beginning of the piece that I just pointed out to you. Right. Now, the second time it comes in, measure 17. 17. Right. Da, 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 the first time it's da 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 da. This was da 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 da. So it's different by a chromatic half step. Okay. Measure 17. Measure 37. Excuse me. Measure 37. Yeah. Da, 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 da. There it is. Okay. There it is. You can see the whole thing is totally coherent. Now comes the carry through development. I'll leave that for the whole piece. Now we're going on to the minuet. I want to show the following. He's comparing it for that figure in the first movement to the one in the second movement here. Okay, now continue. As you can see, they're the same motive. You should always articulate them in the same way when they're played. Otherwise, it's not the same motive anymore. It might happen that the composer will modify the articulation now and then. That happens. But here, I don't see anything like that. Okay, can I have the beginning of the Andante now? At the beginning of the Andante there, show that, please. Yeah. Da-dee-da. Point that out, please. Yeah. Da-dee-da. Right. And just go back to the beginning of the minuet. Right. Da-da-da-da. See? Okay. Okay. And go on now. Extremely closely related. And that also comes from the first movement. It's always the same. Here the theme undergoes further variation. Let's look at one of the variations. Score goes. To show you the contrapuntal element there. Could you put measure 95 back up on the screen? Right, okay.
Einverleibte.
This is a, which Mozart incorporated this. This example is especially good for showing how the contrapuntal style goes hand in hand with Motivführung. The same is basically true for the minuet. You'll hear it. I can't go through everything right now. But in context, all this becomes quite evident, and in the last movement, it's even stronger. So let's go to the last movement. As you can see, Mozart seeks out the chromatic element, which is already present at the beginning of the first movement. Just a, you know, da 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 dum, it's a da da dum. It's just an inversion. It's going upward, downwards here instead of upwards. All contrapuntalists love the chromatic element. Because you modulate very well. And above it and below it, you can write lots of beautiful, flowing counterpoint. Probably the most famous such theme is the musical offering of Bach. I'd like to have this theme played for you. I don't have a representation, but you can hear it. This kind of thematic presents, for example, Bach wrote countless works on this theme. Each one always different. But after all, the theme has such a manifold content. This is the element that Mozart also exploited. And Haydn also recalled it. Right. Look at, go back to the Haydn, and if you could pull out measure 41. Can you do it quickly? Right. There. Da 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 dum. Right there. Da 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 dum. Same thing there. Right. Okay, that's what. So Haydn had it too.
Haydn hat liegt das auch sehr. Er weiß wie gut das für den Chor.
Right, because he knew also knew how good it was from counterpoint.
So, also jetzt wollen wir das Mozart-Quartett in Zusammenhang.
Now let's hear the full one. Now, actually, I've edited this so that you're only going to hear the first and the last movement. Wait.
My dear friends, when you hear this music now, please, don't keep looking for the Motivführung, just listen to the music, because this is important for studying purposes, for musicians and for composers to know to know what to keep track of what they are doing, you see. But actually, the whole system is a challenge to the imagination. It's a discipline and a challenge to the imagination of the composer and the executant. And the result is the music. So don't start looking for this and that. Just listen to the music as it comes out. Thank you very much indeed.
in the beginning, there was the human voice. In the beginning, there was God's voice, gave man a voice. And so at the end, also, right now, we're going to conclude with something vocal. Our Schiller Institute chorus is going to perform another one of Mozart's pearls of Motivführung. It's a motet for chorus and orchestra, Ave Verum Corpus. In this piece, the least action principle you can hear in its full glory. Within a few short bars, Mozart here manages to present a profound musical idea with all the noble simplicity of Lincoln's Gettysburg Address or a speech by our own Amelia Boynton Robinson. Just to point out the main elements of the Motivführung, first we're going to have a rising interval of a fourth on the Ave.
Ave.
Followed by a falling stepwise chromatic figure. It's going to go
Ave.
On the second enunciation. So there are two Aves. It's Ave, Ave, Verum Corpus. Ave means hail in Latin. Do we have the translation up there? Yeah. Okay, fine. Everything else in the entire piece flows from this. The two musical ideas become one at the high point of the piece on the words in mortis examine, right, in the trial of death, in the test of death. When the fourth becomes inverted to a fifth and then is pushed still further by an upward inversion.
In more.
You'll hear that. Right. While at the same time the bass shifts register on its downward chromatic motion at the same time. Okay, I'd like the chorus, pardon us for a little bit of rearrangement here. We have to move the overhead projector, and then I'd like the chorus to assemble up here in front.
Thank you.
that, we conclude this evening's session. Good night.